We'll start a session with him reading a bit of his work. Then as soon as he finishes, we'll have a quick chat, maybe like 20, 30 minutes. How long is our session, ladies? 1 hour. I want to confirm. You know, you heard it's 1 hour, right? So we'll talk between the two of us for about 20, 30 minutes. And then I'll open it to the floor for you all to come in. Is that acceptable?
Yes.
Okay. So Niq, please start.
Can you all hear me? Okay. Good afternoon, everyone.
Good afternoon.
And thanks for welcoming me here in Malawi. It's my first time to be here.
Welcome.
I'm already enjoying myself in this beautiful country. The great music that I had and the great performance earlier on. It's something I'm going to take home. And thank you very much for that. I will read from my latest collection of short stories called Soweto Under the Apricot Tree. It's just the first story that I'm going to read. And you'll excuse my accent. I didn't study in a good school. So the first story is called, it's called My Father's Eyes. The bizarre address you gave me some 10 years ago is still stuck in my memory. I don't expect you to remember it because it was in a weird location. And after all, it did not really mean anything to you. But 93/574 Avalon Cemetery still rings in my mind today. I should have known better than to ask you about my father. Although I was 27 years old and married, I was still so naive. I had been naive about marriage and children as well. But that naivety and my happiness was shattered with the birth of Fufu. Mukiti was convinced it was my fault that our daughter was born with cerebral palsy. He insisted that I must find my father and appease my ancestors with traditional sacrifices to make things right. Normally, a good and traditional umkhonkothi beer for the ancestors is enough, he told me. If not, he threatened to leave me. I was surprised to learn that Mukiti consulted a traditional healer behind my back. He was advised that our fufu would heal if I found my great father. This came as a shock to me, as it did to you, Mama. Mama, you raised me the Christian way, but there I was fooling myself that I was married to a fellow Christian. I still know some verses of the Bible by heart, including your favorite. Therefore, I tell you, whatever you ask for in a prayer, believe you have received it, and it will be yours. That was Mark 11, verse 11 and 24. I really don't know how Mukiti changed so much. Do you still remember how I met him in our church? We were both 18 years old when I noticed him at the Grace in Pimville. You were very skeptic about our intention to marry then. When he proposed at the age of 22, you said we were still very young. I guess you were right. But like a supportive mother, you gave your blessings away. You said maybe it was good, it was God's will. I still remember your words clearly.
Okay, how does that sound? Great. Sounds okay, yeah? Sounds great. Okay, it's a great piece. So, I mean, we are at a Feminart festival,
yeah,
where feminism is supposed to be at the center. Is there a reason why you picked that piece?
Yeah, the reason I picked this piece is because it talks about the reality of our society in South Africa and in Africa as a whole. And also the things that we talk about every day, the movements that are coming out every day. In South Africa, there's a particular problem that we hear about every day. and it's a problem of femicide, where women are killed every day. It's a problem about rape you hear about every day. Even when I left South Africa yesterday, you know, there were biggest news that a minister had done something to somebody, you know, went to the court and whatever. So it's something that we get every day. But there are certain movements that are doing it. So with the piece, I'm writing about the plight of women, more especially the young women in South Africa that are subjected to these atrocities, most of them by their main partners, the ones that they trust so much. I think, I'm not sure whether the main, one of the biggest stories of femicide that came about, it was about 2 weeks ago, 2 months ago actually, when a lady coming from the University of Cape Town, studying at the University of Cape Town, had a parcel at a post office in Cape Town, and then as she went to collect it, the postman killed and tried to rape her. It was the biggest news, it was also televised, you know. And then there was a movement that started as well about that, called Free Nanny Movement, because that was the name. So I think it's the story, it's more related to such kind of problems that we see every day. And I'm trying to, by the story, to you know, make us aware as men, that and also as South Africans, that this is our problem. Maybe we need to interrogate ourselves and then look into the society again. And I think it's the future of South Africa lies with the youth, because they are the ones that can easily, you know, influence decisions in this democratic South Africa.
Oh, good. I think we'll want to talk a bit about that issue of femicide a bit later, right? It's an issue that's very important to us here at the Feminart Book and Arts Festival. But I know a lot of people don't really know who you are. Perhaps you tell us about your the beginning of your work. You have the book called Dog Eat Dog that you wrote in that was published in 2004. So would you like to tell us about how this book came about?
The book came about because I initially wanted to be a lawyer. So I went to the university, I studied law for 4 years, and I failed it. So I looked around and said, okay, what is the easiest thing that is closer that I can maybe make money out of? Because, you know, I used to read a lot of people like Dan Brown and how they've made it, you know. And I thought, you know, when you want to be something, you start by Googling and whatever. And then by that time, there was no Google, you know. So you read a lot about a person and say, wow, they say he's a millionaire. How did he make it to be a millionaire? And you read that he's making maybe more than 40 million, he said he sold so many copies. I thought, okay, if I can write a book, I can be also be a millionaire. And it was the opposite, because books are not selling in most of, you know, in Africa, because of our conditions, poverty and inequality within our societies that, you know, we got other things, better things to do, I think. So I wrote Dog Eat Dog. It's a book that has been translated into Spanish and Italian. It's read in different institutions at the moment. University of New York, for instance, Massachusetts, Connecticut, Vanderbilt, South.
I have to ask, I know I've read somewhere that you said initially when you were writing the book, you were writing it for your fellow college students.
Yeah.
And did they buy like the book a lot, or?
Yeah, actually, they read the book a lot. There's a difference between reading and buying. So, because where I come from, people read, so one copy can secret from that family, and then you go to the next, oh, it's with so-and-so next door, you go there, ah, no, somebody has taken it, you know? So the book circulates until one page is missing, but people have read it. And they think, wow, you are very, and you become a little bit famous around your community. But, and people expect you to be making money, to be no longer using taxis, you know. And at the end of the day, they see you in a taxi, you know, because you are poor, they didn't buy the book, they borrowed it.
They
and they secreted it.
So it's important for us. So who bought it if it was being bought?
Sorry?
Who was buying it? Is that known about it?
No, actually, you know, I don't know about here, but in South Africa, the research says that once you have books, a book, once it sells 1,000 copies, we have 59 million people, I think 59 or 57. But if you sell 1,000 copies, you are a bestseller. Yeah.